because my text is written in English and there are some guests who do not understand Macedonian. First of all,
UMD and Mito for having me here today. It's an honor to be presenting in front of all of you, and I'll do my best to summarize and to convey my topic in its entirety as much as possible in the time allotted to me. I've been told that I only have 15 minutes because we're running a little late with this conference, so I'll do my best to speed through it. A short introduction about myself. I have a BA in political science from the University of Western Ontario in Canada, and I'm currently studying law at the University of Exeter in England. There, I'm quite involved in student life. I'm the publicity officer of the Conservative Future Society, and I'm the social chairman of the Rifle Club. Now, as you all know, my topic has to do with human rights and their lack thereof for Macedonians living in Greece and Bulgaria. The two main items of interest for us are the European Convention on Human Rights and the European Court of Human Rights. So let's start with a bit of history. The Second World War shocked Europe. The violations of human rights that occurred produced widespread outrage throughout the continent. There was seen to be a need for more political, social, and economic unity throughout Europe. As a result, the Council of Europe was established, not to be confused with the European Union, and in 1951, the Convention on Human Rights was ratified by its member states. Currently, all Council of Europe members have signed and ratified the convention. These include Macedonia, Albania, Greece, Bulgaria, and Serbia. Section 1 of the convention outlines the rights and freedoms protected. On the issue of the Macedonian minorities, the European Court has indicated that Articles 10 and 11 are of significant importance, the right to freedom of expression and the right to assembly and association. This is Article 10. As you can see, it states everyone has the right to freedom of expression, and this right shall include the freedom to hold opinions and receive and impart information and ideas without interference by public authority and regardless of frontiers. And Article 11 states everyone has the right of freedom to peaceful assembly and the freedom to associate with others. Although both articles appear to grant clear freedoms, both Articles 10 and 11 produce what are known as qualified rights. What this means is that a state can lawfully infringe upon them via the second point of the article, as you can see there. The right may be restricted if the restrictions are prescribed by law and are necessary in a democratic society. What this means is that a state can produce a law that infringes upon the rights to expression and association. On the onset, it might seem a little hypocritical of the Council of Europe. Why seek to protect a right that can be lawfully infringed? However, such infringement must be necessary in a democratic society. That part is very important. This is the statutory element that has come to the aid of Macedonian minorities when seeking their rights to association. This is because in many cases such restrictions are prescribed by law, but the European courts have stated and decided that they're not necessary for a democratic society, and that's why they strike them through. Now on to the body that enforces these rights. Section 2 of the Convention outlines the establishment of the European Court of Human Rights. Article 19 states, to ensure the observance of the engagements undertaken by the high contracting parties in the convention and the protocols thereunto, there shall be a European Court of Human Rights, hereinafter referred to as the Court. It shall function on a permanent basis. Regardless of admissibility to the court, it is important that the party is a victim of a violation of a convention right. This means that in order to have standing at the court, one must be directly affected by the violation of one's rights. Additionally, Macedonians facing discrimination must first exhaust all domestic remedies before applying to the European Court of Human Rights. What this means is that one cannot directly take a case there. They must first go through the national judicial structures. Article 46 is of particular importance in the Convention. It states, as seen on the screen, the high contracting parties undertake to abide by the final judgment of the court in any case to which they are parties, and the final judgment of the court shall be transmitted to the Committee of Ministers, which shall supervise its execution. What this means is that states are obliged to comply with the judgments of the European Court of Human Rights. This means that both Bulgaria and Greece must accept the judgments of the court and comply with the decisions. This is of particular importance to the Macedonian minorities, as it provides a binding solution for their problems when they are denied their rights by domestic courts. Once a judgment is made, the Committee of Ministers of the Council of Europe is tasked to ensure that the judgment is complied with. If a country refuses to comply with a judgment, there are several options. The state can be suspended or expelled from the Council. Greece has a history of conflict with the Council of Europe, unsurprisingly. It withdrew from 1967 to 1970, following 5 allegations of persecution against it. It is important to note that this was before the Macedonian minority cases came before the court. It is apparent that there are no definite methods of ensuring the enforcement of a European Court of Human Rights judgment. Expulsion from the Council is all that can be done. However, most of the pressure on states to comply with the court's judgments are political. It would harm a European state's image and credibility if it were seen to be denying human rights and human rights remedies. Now, these are the cases that have been brought before the Court of Human Rights in Europe. There are 2 from Greece, the case of Sideropoulos and the case of Uranio Toxo, or Vinojito, and 4 cases in Bulgaria, all having to do with United Macedonian organization, ILINDAN. We're going to start off with the Greek cases simply because the case of Sideropoulos was the first case to be tried at the European Court of Human Rights. The case of Sideropoulos concerns the refusal of Greek authorities to register an association called the Home of Macedonian Civilization. The applicants alleged an Article 11 violation. The Article 11 violation was pretty clear and unambiguous, as it was the denial of the freedom of association. The goals of the organization were related purely to the preservation of culture and folklore in the Lerin, or as it's now known, Florina region of Greece. The Greek courts denied registration because they believed that Macedonians intended to dispute the Greek identity of Macedonia and its inhabitants and undermine Greece's territorial integrity. At the court, several important points were made. The Greek government had argued that the interference of Article 11 rights were justified as it pursued several objectives, including the upholding of Greece's cultural traditions and historical and cultural symbols. The court found that such a name is not legitimate to deny a right under Article 11, Section 2. So the qualified rights principle that I outlined earlier, that rights can be denied if it's seen that they're necessary in a democratic society, Greece tried to use that argument. However, the court said it's not valid because such arguments simply are illogical. This point is very important for Macedonian minorities. Academic commentary stresses that states cannot have a claim to deny a right to assembly by virtue of the view that some of that state's historical symbols may come into question. Additionally, the courts held that stating to have a minority culture and developing a minority culture could not constitute a threat to the democratic society under Article 11, Section 2. An important point made by the court was that the existence of different cultures and minorities in a country is a fact, and that democratic societies must support and even protect such minorities. Academic commentary suggests that this statement produces a sort of positive mandate on states to protect minority identities. And as we'll see, as the case of the Macedonian minorities develop in the European Court, that idea of a positive right to protect minority cultures is solidified by the European Court. Now we'll go on to the case of Uranio Toxo, or Vinojito, or Rainbow, against Greece. The case of Uranio Toxo deals with the Macedonian political party, Vinojito, by that name, and the events that transpired in 1995 after they established a headquarters in Lerin or Florina and affixed a sign stating the party's name in both Greek and Macedonian. Following the posting of the sign, several outrageous things happened. Church leaders called for demonstrations and protests against the, and I quote, enemies of Greece, and called for the party leaders' deportation. The town council organized protests against the applicants. The public prosecutor ordered that police take down the sign, as its inclusion of the Macedonian name could sow discord amongst the local population. Upon affixing a new sign, the party offices were ambushed, with the sign being taken and party members being assaulted. This was followed by another ambush that resulted in the destruction of office equipment and the burning of the office. Upon calling the police, who were only located 500 meters away from the site, the applicants were told that no officers were available to come. Additionally, the public prosecutor took no action against the culprits of the crime, but rather charged four of the party members with inciting discord. That's a picture of Vinošita's offices, and you can see one of the windows there damaged. The court stated that political parties are essential for a democratic and pluralistic system. As such, any measures taken against them affects the freedom of association and therefore democracy of a state. Referring to Sideropoulos, the court stated that under Article 11, states have a duty to abstain from arbitrary measures capable of interfering with the right to free assembly and association. It went on to state that Article 11 rights were not theoretical, but practical and effective. Thus, a state must not just abstain from interfering with such rights, but it must also secure the effective enjoyment of the rights and freedoms of association. Perhaps the most important part of the judgment in reference to the protection of Macedonian minority interests can be found when the court stated that, you can see it up there, it is incumbent upon public authorities to guarantee the proper functioning of an association or political party, even when they annoy or give offense to persons opposed to the lawful ideas or claims they seek to promote. Their members must be able to hold meetings without having to fear that they will be subjected to physical violence by their opponents. Such a fear would be liable to deter other associations or political parties from openly expressing their opinions on highly controversial issues affecting the community. In a democracy, the right to counter-demonstrate cannot extend to inhibiting the exercise of the right to association. Thus, states must protect Macedonian associations even if they feel that their views may offend others, and they must also be able to hold meetings without the fear of violence from their opponents. The court held that the risk of causing tension within the community by using political terms in public does not justify interference with the freedom of association. In relation to the absence of police to protect the party, the court stated that the police should have foreseen the danger of tension and should have taken measures to contain or prevent the violence. Now we'll move on to the cases of the Macedonians in Bulgaria. The first case we'll look at is the case of Stankov and the United Macedonian Organization, Ilinden, in Bulgaria 2002. Because it has a really long name, I'll be referring to it as the case of Stankov. The case dealt with the Bulgarian government's refusal to allow the United Macedonian Organization, Ilinden, registration. The court felt that the aims to unite all Macedonians in Bulgaria on a regional and cultural basis and to achieve the recognition of the Macedonian minority in Bulgaria were directed against the unity of the nation, advocated ethnic hatred, and were dangerous for the territorial integrity of Bulgaria. We could see similar arguments being used by Bulgaria as Greece tried to use. In 1994, the organization was denied authorization to hold a meeting to celebrate a historical event. Several members were issued warnings from the police to stay away from the locations. On the day of the event, members and organizations were blocked by police from entering the location. In the following years, several other attempts to receive permission to hold meetings were denied. Reasons were not given, or when they were, it was that such meetings public order or that the organization was not legitimate. In finding Article 11 violations, the court stated that Article 10 must also be considered. This is because the freedom of expression is one of the objectives of the freedom of assembly and association. Freedom of expression constitutes one of the essential state's cultural traditions and historical and cultural symbols. Two, stating to have a Macedonian minority culture and developing a minority culture could not constitute a threat to democratic society under Article 11, Section 2. The goals of promoting and preserving Macedonian traditions and full cultures are legitimate, and inhabitants of regions are entitled to form associations to pursue such goals. The existence of different cultures and minorities in a country is a fact, and democratic societies must support and protect such minorities. Article 11 rights are not theoretical, but practical and effective. Thus, a state must not just abstain from interfering with such rights, but it must also secure the effective enjoyment of the rights to the freedom of association. Political parties are essential for a democratic pluralistic system. As such, any measures taken against them affects the freedom of association and therefore the democracy of the state. The dissolution of a Macedonian party could only be taken in the most extreme cases. Bulgaria and Greece must guarantee the proper functioning of an association or political party, even when that association gives offense to others. They must be able to hold meetings without the fear of violence from their opponents. When the danger of tension is foreseeable, the police should take measures to contain or prevent violence. It is the authorities' role to ensure that political groups tolerate themselves rather than removing the cause of tension, which in many cases is the Macedonians themselves. Macedonians have the right to express themselves not just in manners that are deemed appropriate by the state, but also in ways that can be deemed offensive, shocking, or disturbing. Article 11 additionally gives the right to demonstrate in ways that may be offensive or annoying. The state should promote tolerance and coexistence between different groups. If Macedonian minorities call for autonomy or secession of a region, that cannot automatically give rise to the prohibition of association. There are two conditions upon which Macedonian organizations can call upon the legal and constitutional structures of the state for autonomy. The means used must, in every respect, be legal and democratic, and the change proposed must be compatible with fundamental democratic principles. Greece and Bulgaria cannot ban Macedonian minority meetings, demonstrations, and the dissemination of their ideas. This can only occur if the groups call for violence or reject democratic principles. Although Article 11 only makes mention of the right to, for trade unions to be formed, as the cases of Sidiropolis and Ilinden have shown, the right for Macedonians to form associations is inherent and protected by Article 11. European law set out by the Convention supersedes domestic legislation. This means that Bulgaria and Greece must ensure that the laws they enact protect the rights enshrined by the Convention. Lastly, Article 10 is linked to Article 11 in that freedom of expression is one of the objectives of the freedom of association. Now, what's next? I put that image up there for a reason. If we were in Greece or Bulgaria right now, we could have this meeting shut down by the police, we could have neo-Nazis come in here and assault us, we could be thrown in jail, we could have our organization be banned, all for just showing one image, one idea. What we can do as Macedonians in the diaspora, especially Macedonians living in Europe whose member states are in the Council of Europe, is lobby our politicians to put pressure on Greece and Bulgaria to respect the judgments of the European Court of Human Rights as they should. Thank you very much.
My name is Dr. Victoria Chavkovska. Good afternoon. I specialized in international law, and I'm glad to see that after so many historical themes, we are intertwining history and law. Without history, we cannot continue. Alexander's paper shows that. And again, thanks to UMD that enabled me after 3 years to come back here and talk more on the Macedonian matters. What is important as regards to Alexander's paper is the political dimension of the interpretation of the Strasbourg decisions. This political interpretation is not intertwined by accident along all these years in the past, because that is related to the functioning and operation of the democratic values enshrined in the preamble of the organization, something that has been undertaken by the principles of the United Nations. And it's not by accident, since the Council of Europe was created in a time where peace was necessary. What I want to point out, unlike other international organizations, is that Council of Europe tries to impose itself as a single organization where the right of individual appeal or complaint is guaranteed for all the signatory parties, and maybe through the cases of the international organizations in Bulgaria against Republic of filed against Republic of Bulgaria, it was shown that it's not sufficient only to bring the court the case before the court, because the system of the European Convention and the court received enormous number of complaints. It's not only the cases that were mentioned here against Republic of Bulgaria, but it was shown that states faced deficit of of exercising of democratic rights and democratic principles. So once you see violation of a right, why do you repeat it as a state? And it was stated by one of the judge, because I was 3 years in Strasbourg, the standing mission over there, that Bulgaria is one of the states, it's in a critical zone of states that has 60% of repetition of the same complaints. So our organization was re-registered in Republic of Bulgaria, and again it didn't manage to pass the quota in the first instance court. And also again there are very few papers that actually talk about this subject matter, because initially we're talking about the relationship between international case law and domestic law, and they do not realize that the international conventions are mandatory. However, the instruments of the court, the Council of Europe, and the pressure of the Council of Europe in this particular case, Republic of Bulgaria, are neglectable. What I want to say, when it comes to Republic of Bulgaria, on several occasions it was shown that Republic of Bulgaria would have to undertake serious measures in order to modify its legislation. Several occasions that was stated by the Venice Commission as an independent legal body whose reports are not mandatory for the constituents. However, other monitoring mechanisms that address this issue is that are the reports of the Parliament Assembly. Mr. Hall, I was present there when he stated the report of Republic of Bulgaria. I'm not repeating myself, I just wanted to state some classical examples that Bulgaria is actually only does cosmetic modifications to its legislation, tries to identify modes in which it will omit application of international conventions. Are there any questions? We have one question. Even though I had no intention to comment, 1 minute, I'm a former judge, I'm a state prosecutor, I'm a lawyer, and I was quite inspired, in addition to Dr. Chepreganov's overview of the historic event, particularly glad that the younger generation, such as Alexander Karapancev, they can give a legal aspect of the human rights within the Macedonian question. Even though I've been dealing with these issues all my life, for a young man with such paper and views, I'm glad to see that we are skilled enough to present our issue legally. Since for the first time, the cases that he, of the persons he mentions in Vinožita and the other ones, some of them are my personal friends, and in particular the relation with the international community and the Council of Europe, it's good that they will realize that we have here awareness high enough to respect and to talk about human rights. Congratulations again. I tried with this paper to show that our brothers and sisters in Bulgaria and Greece do not enjoy and exercise rights that rightfully belong to them. And we need to show this to the world, that this is a true evidence on our behalf. It's not something that is disputable or discussed by Greece and Bulgaria in a way in which they do with our history, because this is law.